In the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Christ alone, our hope is found. He is our light, our strength, our song. That's one of the songs we sing here at Cross Connection, and it expresses exactly what we're studying here in Colossians chapter 2 today. Open with us in Colossians chapter 2 as we consider the fact that Jesus alone is the focus of our faith.
Magic is the art of deception. It can be one of the most frustrating things, watching a talented magician or illusionist, whether they're making something disappear through sleight of hand, or they're appearing to read your thoughts, read your mind with a deck of cards, it can be frustrating to watch, especially when you are the focus of their trick. It's compounded when you're surrounded by other people who are watching you as you're the focus of the deception or the trick. It's even greater when there's something on the line. Maybe the person says, "I'll bet you $10 that I can guess your card." And now when something's on the line and you can't figure out what it is that they did or how they did it, there's frustration. Have you been there before? I remember one time the frustration was kind of turned the other way, though. I was out with Pastor Josh. We were having lunch on the east end of town, and this guy walks in and walks up to our table and starts wanting to show us magic tricks. If you've lived in North County, especially the east end of Escondido or Valley Center for any length of time, you may have at one point in time met Left Eddie. Some of you know who Left Eddie is. He's an interesting character. I don't even know if he's still around or still alive. I haven't seen him for years, but Left Eddie has got an incredible scar on his face over his left eye. When he was in high school, he had a high school shop accident, and a 2x4 came up and hit him. He was in a coma for a long period of time. He has a glass eye. But Eddie wanted to show us some tricks, and so he kept showing us magic tricks, and every time he'd show us a trick, Josh would go, "No, I can do that." And Eddie got so angry. Finally, Eddie sat down at our table. He goes, "I got a trick you can't do." And Josh goes, "Oh, okay." And he picked up a knife. He went, "Tink, tink, tink, tink," against his glass eye. "Yep, I can't do that one." But it's frustrating when you're the focus of the trick, when something's on the line. But what if it's something greater than just $10 on the line? The frustration increases when there's something of more value. The Apostle Paul was frustrated by the deception, the cunning, deceitful trickery of the enemy, our adversary, the devil, and of those that may be in some way swayed by or directed by him. As he writes the passage of Scripture that we're going to be looking at today, Colossians chapter 2, if you'd open your Bibles there near the end of your Bible. Colossians chapter 2, if you don't have a Bible, you can raise your hand and one of our ushers will bring you one. Right after the books of Ephesians and Philippians, Colossians 2 verse 4. Would you stand with me as we read this passage of Scripture? The apostle writes, "Now this I say, lest anyone should deceive you with persuasive words. For though I am absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in the spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, who is the head of all principality and power. In him you were also circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, by the putting off of the body of sins of the flesh, by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. And you, being dead in trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us. And he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers. He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. So let no one judge you in food or in drink or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbaths, which are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. Let no one cheat you. Let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility and worship of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom all the body, nourished and knit together by joints and ligaments, grows with the increase that is from God. Therefore, if you died with Christ from the basic principles of the world, why? As though living in the world, do you subject yourselves to regulations? Do not touch, do not taste, do not handle, which all concern things which perish with the using, according to the commandments and doctrines of men. These things indeed have an appearance of wisdom and self-imposed religion, false humility, and the neglect of the body, but are of no value against the indulgence of the flesh. Father, as we look at this important passage of Scripture, I ask that you would give us wisdom and understanding beyond what is just natural, that we would have a supernatural understanding by your Holy Spirit, and that your word and the work of your Spirit would be effective and active in our lives, transforming us today. Transform us by the renewing of our minds, that we may show forth your glory in a world that is in such need of light and grace and truth. Make us conduits through which your grace flows. Make us beacons through which your light shines. Make us salt to a world that has need of flavor and preservation. God, do a work in us that only can be the work of your grace and your Spirit. We ask this in Jesus' name, and all those that agreed said, amen. Amen. You can be seated. It was there, as Paul was in prison in Rome 2,000 years ago, that word came to him from a minister, a leader, a pastor of the church called the church at Colossae. Colossae was a city about 1,000 miles away from Rome, and word had come to Paul about the church and the Christians that lived there. Although he'd never met them, his heart was with them, because the one who had planted that church and pastored that church had been a disciple of Paul's ministry. And so it was a fruit, the fruit of his work, and so his heart was with this church. And he hears a word that was not, it was not a foreign thing to him in that day, that there had begun to come into the church there at Colossae false teaching, false doctrine, what we might refer to as unorthodox or heresy, that was shifting the focus away from Jesus. Any teaching that moves the focus away from Jesus is unorthodox. It's heresy. And so when he hears about this, that this is coming by cunning, trickery, by deception, he is gripped with what we might refer to as righteous indignation, but it's just anger. He's mad. He's mad that the enemy, our adversary, the devil, the Bible describes this adversary as cunning and wily. He's mad that this one had been able to get into another church and was moving them away from the truth, so he wrote this letter. And I am grateful 2,000 years later that we have this letter. I'm glad that he wrote this letter, because the same problems that they were facing 2,000 years ago are the very same things that the church has faced ever since and faces today. This is why it's so important that we be students of the Bible, because the Bible is relevant based on the fact that the enemy still works in the same way today that he did 2,000 years ago. His tactics have not changed. And so Paul writes to this church, and he gives in this passage four cautions to the church there at Colossae that would be cautions to us here at the Church of California as well. The first one begins there in verse 4. As Paul says, "Now this I say to you, lest anyone should deceive you." Caution number one, don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. Now this word deceived, it means to be deluded or cheated by false reasoning. Deluded or cheated by false reasoning. This passage of Scripture and all the other New Testament passages were written originally in the Greek language, and the word used here for deceived is paralogizomai. Para meaning with or in the vicinity of, and logizomai, logic. It's somewhere in the vicinity of logic. It seems logical, but it's not. Don't be deceived by false reasoning, something that seems to be true. It's so close to truth, and that's why it's so deceptive. And the enemy is so good at this. Things that are just so close to the truth, and yet it is deceptive. It sounds logical. It seems right, but isn't. It's what we'd refer to as a counterfeit. The word counterfeit, it simply means made in the exact imitation of something valuable or important with the intent to deceive or to defraud. With the intent to deceive or to defraud. There's not a week that goes by that my spam folder on my computer does not fill with email messages about Ray-Ban glasses for $12.95 and Oakley sunglasses for $11. And I can guarantee you, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that they are Folkleys and not Oakleys, but they look just like the real thing. Counterfeits. And oh, are they so good in this world at counterfeits. And they're so close that it's hard to tell the difference. And so Paul says, do not be deceived by the counterfeit. Do not be deceived, he says, by persuasive words. But the question is, since it is so close to the truth that it can be persuasive, how can we not be deceived or defrauded by these persuasive counterfeit arguments? Well, the easiest way would be to have someone like the Apostle Paul with you at all times, right? How great would that be? Going through life and someone starts to tell you their philosophy, their idea, their thought on the world and where it came from, and their thought on God and what Jesus is all about. And you got the Apostle Paul, the guy who wrote Romans, standing right there. He goes, oh, hey, I object. In Romans chapter 6, verse 19, I wrote this. Wouldn't that be nice to have your own pocket apostle everywhere you go? We don't have that. None of us have that or will have that. So notice what Paul says in the very next verse, verse 5. For though I am absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in the spirit. I'm not with you. I won't be with you everywhere you go, every time you meet someone who may be deceptive, who's trying to give you some truth that isn't really truth. It looks like truth and it seems to be close to truth, but I'm not with you in the flesh to be able to say no, but I'm with you in spirit. He goes on, rejoicing to see your good order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. I may not be with you, but I have joy. I'm filled with joy to hear about your foundation, your strong steadfastness, and your confident trust in Christ alone. We just sang, last song we sang, in Christ alone, in Christ alone. And Paul says, I'm filled with joy because that's where your confidence lies. It is in him and him alone. And so to not be deceived by counterfeit, you must have a firm faith in Jesus Christ. Writing to another church right around the same period of time, it's just a couple books to the left of Colossians. You can turn there if you'd like, Ephesians chapter 4. There in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 14, Paul writes this. We, if you're a follower of Jesus today, this includes you, we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro, carried about by every wind of doctrine or teaching. We should no longer be children, which is implied we should grow up. This last summer was maybe the first summer that our oldest son, Ethan, who's now just turned 7, he started to get the courage, a little bit more courage, to go a little bit further out into the water at the beach. And even though Ethan is a gargantuan 7-year-old at 4'8" and 75 pounds and still wants me to carry him upstairs from time to time, as he started to venture out a little bit further, you know how it is, watching a smaller framed person, a little child there in the waves being pushed around by the waves. It's not until you've had a few more Thanksgivings under your belt that you can stand strong there in those waves. And so we've all seen that before, being tossed to and fro, and a little child. It's even more interesting to watch when it's a small 2-year-old or 3-year-old running down into the waves and they get hit by what really is only coming up to your knees, and yet it takes them out. And so here Paul says, we as followers of Jesus should no longer be like little children tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. But notice this, it's not just by the different teachings that come from various places, but he goes on, by the trickery of men, by the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. We need to recognize that there are deceivers among us. No, not necessarily right here in this room, I hope, although I know that it's very possible. There are deceivers among us within the church that would seek to come in and to spread what the Bible refers to as damnable heresies, destructive teachings, even what is referred to as the doctrines of demons, demonic false teaching that seeks to remove your focus and my focus from Christ to something else. To take it away from being a Christocentric focus and to fix it on something that seems so good and so logical and seems religious and seems right and it makes sense. And Paul says, don't be deceived by persuasive words. There are destructive heresies that come through. Counterfeits. Counterfeits. And what Paul reveals here in this passage is that our faith and our confidence in Christ needs to be so steadfast, so strong, that we know the authentic so well that when the counterfeit comes, we see it instantly. A number of years ago, our church ran a coffee shop down on Grand Avenue here in Escondido called His Place. Anybody remember His Place? I met my wife working at His Place while I was working there. Pastor Nick met his wife while he was working at His Place. If for no other reason, His Place was a great investment of our time as a church. But I remember one day there, as I was working in the afternoon, our manager at the time, Jason, was counting through $20 bills to go do a deposit, and he's going through them very, very quickly, and he hit one, and he goes, whoa, that one didn't feel right. I went, what are you talking about? And he kind of went through it again, and he separated the smaller stack, and he went through it again and separated the smaller stack until he came upon one that felt different. In appearance, it looked identical to the other $20 bills that it was there with, and yet it felt different, and indeed it was a counterfeit. To put it next to a $20 bill, just to look at it from a distance, unless you had an incredibly trained eye to see what is a counterfeit, you or I would probably look at it and say, no, it's real. But the feeling of it was different. There was something about it that didn't feel right. Or to put it another way, the smell test. Every one of you know the smell test, especially around this time of year, right after a holiday. You know how it is. You pack up everything after Thanksgiving into little Tupperware things, and you put them in the refrigerator. And refrigerators have this devious nature to them to where things just find their way to the back. I don't know how it happens, but they're a little too deep. And you know you're going through looking for something, and you go, oh, wow, that looks good. And you open it, whoa, no, that doesn't smell right. We know the smell test. It might look good, but it doesn't smell right. And we need to come to the place in our walk with Jesus as followers of Jesus that we've come to the place where we can judge whether or not something's right or wrong just because it doesn't pass the smell test or that doesn't feel right. This doesn't always mean that you know exact chapter and verse to be able to say this doesn't fit because of this verse here in Ecclesiastes chapter 5. You may not be able to do that with such perfection. But there's a sense in which you say, no, that doesn't feel right. When someone says to you, God helps those who help themselves, you go, no, that doesn't seem right to me. I don't think that's in the scriptures. Or when someone says, God will never give you anything that you cannot handle, you go, well, I don't know that that's actually biblical. It doesn't pass the smell test. Or if you hear someone say, if you are a follower of God, nothing bad will ever happen to you. Anybody ever heard that one before? And you go, well, wait, no, that just doesn't seem to fit with the scriptures. Or sometimes you'll hear people say, if you're a Christian, you'll be blessed with health and prosperity. And you go, it doesn't pass the smell test. Or my favorite, if you had more faith, you wouldn't be sick. And these things can sometimes be said in such a way, you know, there was a study done not too long ago by a research group, and they found that a vast majority, I don't remember the numbers, a vast majority of Bible-reading Christians thought that the Bible actually says cleanliness is next to godliness. If you've been said, if it's been said to you enough times and it seems to sound really good, and if you add a thee or a thou or a shalt in there, it's probably in the Bible. And so we begin to think that these things are there, but we need to come to a place where we know the scriptures well enough that we know, no, that doesn't work. And so to not be deceived, Paul says this, Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord. There we need to stop. If you have received Christ Jesus the Lord today, if Jesus of Nazareth, who died on a cross 2,000 years ago and rose from the dead, is Lord in your life and you believe him to be Christ, the anointed Son of God, this is for you. If you're a Christian, as you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him. Get to know him. Spend time with him. How do you do that since he's in heaven now? Well, rooted and built up in him. Okay, that sounds good. You've got to be finding your depth of root in him, being built up in him. How? Established in the faith. Growing in the faith. How? By getting to know God through his word, by spending time with God in worship, by spending time with God's people in fellowship. As you do these things, you're established in the faith. As you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Point number one in your outline. Be strong in your faith and you won't be deceived. Be strong in your faith and you won't be deceived. If you're a follower of Jesus today, you need to recognize this, even though it's against the view, the modern view of many in our world today. There is an enemy, the adversary, the devil, and he preys on the weak. He preys on the weak. He loves to go after the easy prey. He goes about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. We've all seen the National Geographic or Discovery Channel thing of the lion. They go after the weak or the young or those that are not mature in the herd to try and separate that one. And the enemy, the adversary, the devil, he goes about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And so we need to be strong in our faith, rooted and built up in him through solid biblical teaching. And what is given here on a Sunday morning, I work very hard that this would be solid and biblical teaching, but even I, your pastor, I listen to solid biblical teaching all week long. I listen to great Bible teachers online through podcasts, and I encourage you to do the same so that you would grow. That's how you come to the place where when someone says something that is off the wall, even though it sounds so close, you can say, whoa, wait, hold on a second. That doesn't seem right. When someone knocks on your door and they say, well, let me show you this passage here in my Bible in John chapter 1. And there it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was a God. You go, well, wait a minute, that doesn't seem right. Why doesn't it seem right? Because you've read John chapter 1 verses 1 through 4 so many times, you say, that's not correct. There are those who will deceive. And the scriptures say that there comes a time where even those who may be deceived or even those that are the elect, those who seem to be strong. And so, we must be strong in our faith. Not just strong in religion, because here's the thing. You can be religiously strong and weak in faith. You can do all the right religious things, say and also with you at the same time, and stand and genuflect at the right time, and partake in the right way, and be baptized in the right method, and all these sort of things. You can do all these things religiously just right and have a weak faith. And be easily swayed by persuasive words. And so Paul here is encouraging us to lose our religion and strengthen our faith. And so his first caution, don't be deceived. Second, verse 8, don't be cheated. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. The word cheated here, it means to be seduced or carried off or led away. Do not be seduced or carried off or led away. I love the way the New Living Translation translates this. It says, don't let anyone capture you with empty philosophies and high-sounding nonsense. Heard any high-sounding nonsense lately? Don't let anyone capture you with empty philosophies and high-sounding nonsense that come from human thinking and from spiritual powers of this world rather than from Christ. Don't let anyone capture you with vain, deceptive philosophy, high-sounding nonsense. What is vain, deceptive philosophy and high-sounding nonsense of human tradition and worldly wisdom? Well, Paul answers it for us. Look at verses 9 and 10. For in him, Jesus, all the fullness of the Godhead is bodily. In him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, who is the head of all principality and power. So high-sounding, nonsensical, vain philosophy can be summed up as any teaching that says that Jesus is not enough. Any teaching that says what he did on the cross is insufficient. Here Paul says, in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him. Any teaching that says that you're not complete unless you have this other thing, I'm glad you have Jesus, but you need this also, is high-sounding, nonsensical, empty philosophy. We could go on and on about some examples of what high-sounding, empty philosophies are, but Paul gives us some. Look at verses 11 through 15. In him, in Jesus, you were also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands by the putting off of the body of sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, in which you also were raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. And you, being dead in trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he is made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which is contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Vain human traditions, worldly wisdom. What is it? Well, there's at least three things that I see Paul cites here in this passage. The first is circumcision. Now I realize to us sitting here coming up on 2016 in a purely Western culture, circumcision may seem like an odd thing that Paul would center on, but 2,000 years ago in the church of Colossae, it was a big deal. Because every first follower of Jesus for about the first 20 years of the Christian faith was a Jewish person. Because Christianity first started there as Christ died on a cross in Jerusalem and rose from the dead and began to spread among Jewish individuals. As it moved out towards non-Jewish Gentiles, how many Gentiles, non-Jews here today? Raise your hand. God bless you, that's most of us. As it started to move out from there, something that was a center focal point of the Jewish faith, circumcision, and I know it may be strange to us living 2,000 years later, but it was very important to the Jewish faith at that time and the covenant that God made with Abraham in Genesis chapter 17 is where it all started. There, it was very important, and it began to be something that was preached along with the gospel by many first followers of Jesus. And so you have many years passes, about 30 years later, the gospel comes to this place called Colossae, and there in this place is purely Gentiles, and they start to be evangelized, and as they start to receive the gospel, there's a group of people that follow in on the heels of the gospel, and they say, we're really glad that you put your faith in Jesus Christ, but you also need this to be right with God. Circumcision. Let's see just how committed you really are. Now, it may not be something here in our day, circumcision specifically, but the principle is still there. The principle is still there. People say, I'm really glad you put your faith in Jesus Christ, but unless you've been baptized in this church, your hope is not secure. I'm really glad you put your faith in Jesus Christ, but unless you've been partaking of the communion in this way, your hope is not really founded. I'm glad you put your faith in Jesus Christ, but unless you worship on this day, you have no real hope. If you worship on any other day, you've got a problem. And so now the focus removes from Christ, and it goes to something else. It's no longer a Christocentric faith. Now it's been shifted to some other sort of thing. If you're being told or taught that that you must do some religious rite of purification or some ritual to be right with God, then that is, as Paul puts it here, vain, deceptive, high-sounding nonsense. It's either Christ and Christ alone, or it's nonsense. Not just circumcision. He also speaks here of asceticism. What is asceticism? Well, simply self-denial. Some sort of self-discipline and self-denial that if you want to be not righteous, but more righteous. That's typically the way it's framed. I'm really glad you put your faith in Christ, but if you really want to be a good Christian, if you really want to be more righteous with Christ, then you need to do this and this and this to make yourself more righteous with Christ. You need to deny this pleasure. You need to deny this hunger. You need to deny this appetite. And if you do these things, then you will be more righteous. You know, the reality is that we, in our natural selves, we love that. Why? Because we love to be better. Don't we? We love to be better. Oh, how we yearn to be better than some other people. And you know what? Religion is really, really good at making us feel better. It really does a great job of making us feel better in so many ways. It deals with the consciousness of sinful failing. And here I did this and I didn't do this and now I feel better. And then we feel even better because not only do we feel better about ourselves, but we can look down at other people and say, well, they're not as good as me and that makes me feel even better. And we get a bigger and fatter head. And we like that. And not just circumcision or religious rites, not just asceticism. Finally, he also speaks to legalism. Legalism, works righteousness. I have to do it this way to be right, to be more right. It's an obvious and continual false teaching over the last 2,000 years of church history. Legalism teaching you that by rules, by regulations, by rites, by rituals, you will be made more righteous. If you're being told or taught that some religious rule-keeping will make you more right with God, it is vain, deceptive, high-sounding, nonsensical philosophy. Point number two on your outline. Christ is enough to make the unrighteous righteous. Christ is enough to make the unrighteous righteous. So much so that I can stand before you today and say, I am righteous. I'm righteous. Not because of any religious thing that I've done, not because of the way in which I was baptized, not because of the way in which I partake of communion, not because of my prayer life, not because of my Bible reading schedule, not because of how often I fast, which needs to probably be more anyway, but not because of any of those things that I've done, not because of where I was born or how much money I make or what kind of car I drive, not because of what church I go to or how I serve in that church or how I give to that church. I am righteous today because of Christ. And it is not pompous and it is not arrogant to say, I am righteous if I found my righteousness in Christ. In Christ alone. My hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. I can't say, in baptism alone, my hope is found. Or in the Eucharist alone, my hope is found. Or in Cross Connection Church, my hope is found. In Christ alone. My hope is found. And so Paul says it's not circumcision, it's not asceticism, it's not legalism. He says don't be deceived by false logic, don't be seduced by religious effort. His third caution is given in verse 16, so let no one judge you. Let no one judge you in food or in drink or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbaths. The word judge there means to condemn or to censure or to call into question. Don't allow anyone to call your faith into question because you don't do the thing that they do. You don't observe the thing that they observe. And therefore, you're not where you need to be with God because you don't observe this day or that. Or you do observe that day and you shouldn't. Don't let anyone judge you. Don't allow anyone to judge you because you keep or you don't keep the Jewish dietary rules or restrictions. Don't let anyone judge you because you keep or you don't keep the Jewish feast days. Don't let anyone judge you because you keep or you don't keep some liturgical calendar of events. Don't let anyone judge you because you keep or you don't keep some holy Sabbath day. Keep or don't keep the Sabbath. Others may judge you, Jesus does not. Keep or don't keep Christmas. Others may judge you, Jesus does not. It's amazing to me every year when we get around Christmas and I mention Christmas and we decorate this place as we probably will this next week with some Christmas sort of things, and I always get an anonymous note. Every single year for the last 5 years, I get an anonymous note. God bless you if you send me that note. And they tell me how Christmas is a pagan holiday and we shouldn't be celebrating Christmas, and why are we celebrating Christmas? It's a pagan holiday. I have yet to meet, in my 36 years now of life, I've yet to meet the person who celebrates the winter solstice. When I do, I let you know. I will let you know. I assume they have dreadlocks and smell of patchouli oil. I've not met that person yet. Every person I've met that celebrates Christmas celebrates it because it's the birth of Christ that we're celebrating. Okay, fine. Maybe he didn't, wasn't born on December 25th. I'm perfectly fine with that. You say you can't bring a Christmas tree into your home or into the church. Don't you know that's a pagan symbol? I don't care what kind of symbol it was originally. I know what I teach it to my children as. Jesus died on a tree. He is the light of the world on a tree, and we light up this tree to remember the light of the world was given forth on the tree, the cross of Calvary. That's all we're doing. Observe or don't observe Christmas, but don't judge people for observing or not observing Christmas. Eat pork or don't eat bacon. Others may judge you. I might, but Jesus does not. Observe the Feast of Trumpets or don't observe the Feast of Trumpets. Others may judge you. Jesus does not. If that thing, the Sabbath, not eating this food, observing Christmas, observing the Feast of Trumpets, if it directs your worship to God and focuses your attention on Jesus, God bless you. If that thing brings you closer to Christ in your worship and adoration of Him, God bless you. But if that thing becomes your focus and now you define yourself by that day, there's a problem. It's not my intent to pick on anyone, but if you define yourself as my whole center of life as a follower of Jesus has to do with the seventh day, and anyone who does not worship on that day, then you've defined yourself by the wrong thing. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my strength, my hope, my song. As soon as you move into the place of judging someone else for their observance or non-observance of some certain thing, a dietary restriction, a day, you've made yourself Lord, and you've become a legalist. Again, are these religious things bad? No, if they bring you closer to Jesus. But if they move you away from Christ or cause you to be a condemner, a judge of other people, then it has become a stumbling block. These things are not bad, Paul even says. Look at Colossians chapter 2, verse 17. All these things are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. The focus is Jesus. What was the purpose of Passover? What was the purpose of Pentecost? What was the purpose of Yom Kippur or the Feast of Trumpets or the Feast of Tabernacles? The purpose was all Jesus. He is the focus. And if these things don't center your focus more on Jesus Christ, then you've lost focus. Point number 3 on your outline. Holy days don't make you holy. Jesus does. Holy days don't make you holy. Jesus does. None of us is holy apart from Christ. None of us will ever make ourselves holy by keeping some dietary restriction, by observing some specific day over another day. And so Paul says, do not be deceived by false logic. Do not be seduced by religious effort. Do not be judged by the religiously righteous, those who think themselves righteous by their religious actions. Finally, fourth, verse 18, let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility and the worship of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. Now in verse 8, the word cheat was used. And now here again in verse 18, the word cheat is used. The same English word, but different Greek word. And here the Greek word for let no one cheat you, it means to decide against, to declare one unworthy, or to rob of the prize, to be defrauded of the prize. And so Paul here says to the church at Colossae and to us living 2,000 years later, don't let anyone rob you of your joyful reward in Christ because you do not do the religious or spiritual things that they do. Don't let anyone rob you of your joy in Christ because you do not do the religious thing that that person does. And that religious thing that that person does might indeed bring them closer to Christ Jesus, but if they're using it merely as a tool to judge you or make themselves feel better, then it's wrong for them and for you. And so he says, don't let anyone rob you of your joy in Christ Jesus because you don't keep these things the way that these other people might keep them. What things? Well, he speaks of overstated humility. Overstated humility, what is that? Well, he goes on and he talks about the worship of angels. It's a weird thing that's going on here in this verse. An overstated humility which presents itself in that that person feels unworthy to come before God himself. Therefore, they need to go through some angel or some other avenue to get to God. I'm so unworthy and I'm so lost that I can't come directly to Jesus, so I need to go through this priest or this medium to actually get to God. And Paul says that's a false humility. Why? Yes, you're unworthy. Yes, you're a wicked sinner. Yes, I'm totally fallen and in need of the grace of God. But Jesus is the mediator between God and man. He made it possible so that you and I can come before a holy God because he has clothed us in his righteousness. And not in our own. And so he made the way open for us to have access to God. Such spiritualizers put their faith in their spiritual experience and not in the focus of our faith in Jesus Christ. And speaking of such individuals, Paul continues. Look at verse 19. Not holding fast to the head, capital H, to Jesus. They're not holding fast to Jesus, from whom the whole body, nourished and knit together in joints and ligaments, grows with the increase that is from God. Jesus is the head of the church. He ought to be the one that we look to, that we trust in. We need nothing else. Point number 4 on your outline. Don't be defrauded by spiritual frauds who seek to rob you of the joy that you have and the simplicity that is in Jesus Christ. Don't be defrauded by spiritual frauds. Paul continues, verse 20, therefore, if you died with Christ from the basic principles of the world, why, as though living in the world, do you subject yourselves to regulations? Do not touch, do not taste, do not handle, as if these regulations make you right with God or more right with God, which all concern things which perish with the using, according to the commandments and the doctrines of men. Why do you subject yourself to these things? They're not going to make you more right. As I said a moment ago, we love religion. And you know, even the Apostle Paul, he wrote in the book of Romans, the law of God is holy, just, and good. But although the law of God is holy, just, and good, it cannot make you or me holy, just, or good. The purpose of the law is to reveal in its holiness, in its perfect justness, in its absolute goodness, how lost we are. And it is incredibly good at doing that. Any of us who have tried at some point in our lives, and most Christians have experienced a period of time, most of the time early in their faith, where they walk through a time of legalism, trying to make themselves more right with God through their religious law-keeping. Anyone who's tried that comes to the dreadful conclusion that Paul speaks of in Romans chapter 7. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from the body of this death? The law was given that sin might abound, that it might become exceedingly sinful, that we might realize just how lost we are. It exposes our unrighteousness, and boy, is it good at it. Over the last few months, my oldest son is now in first grade, and he's starting to learn how to read, and he's become a constant conscience for me when I'm driving. Maybe you've experienced this. We'll be driving down the street, and he'll ask me, this happens probably 3 times a week as we're driving to school, Dad, how fast are you going? I look down, and I'm going 45. Didn't that sign say 35? Yes. Yes, it did. The law was given so that the offense might abound and show you just how sinful you are. And if you try to live the law, you know very quickly how sinful you are and how in need of a Savior we are. The struggle is real, isn't it? Verse 23. These things, religious rites, the law, all these feast days, indeed have an appearance of wisdom and self-imposed religion, false humility, and the neglect of the body. But, circle the word but, they are of no value. Now notice he does not stop there. It's not that they have no value, period. They have no value against the indulgence of the flesh. These things might be very good religious sort of things to draw you closer to God and exalt him more in your life. But if you think that these things are going to deal with your flesh, to deal with your unrighteousness, you are sadly mistaken. These things indeed have an appearance of wisdom and self-imposed religion and false humility and the neglect of the body, but are of no value against the indulgence of the flesh. Therefore, point number 5, invest your efforts in that which is truly valuable. Invest your efforts in that which is truly valuable. If your religious efforts are for the purpose of making you look or feel more spiritual, then it's vain religion and not a Christocentric faith. If your religious efforts are for the purpose of making you feel or look more spiritual, it's vain religion, and I beg you to lose your vain religion. It's exactly what the Apostle Paul experienced. He writes of it in the book of Philippians. It's just a couple pages to the left of Colossians. Look at Philippians chapter 3, and we'll close with this. Verse 1. Paul says, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. For me to write the same things to you is not tedious, and for you it is safe. Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of the mutilation. Who are they? The ones who come in, who try to seduce us away from a Christocentric faith. For we are the circumcision who worship God in spirit. We rejoice in Christ Jesus. We have no confidence in the flesh. Though I also may have confidence in the flesh, if anyone thinks himself to have confidence in the flesh, I more so. Why? Because I was circumcised the 8th day of the stock of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, concerning the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning righteousness, which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gain to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. He came to find that those things were vain religion in his life, and he left them to gain Christ. Yet indeed I count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and I count them as rubbish. Why? That I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness which is from the law, but that which is through the faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. How might I attain to the resurrection of the dead? Not through my religious law keeping, not through my observance of feast days or fasting. Through Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my strength. He is my song. Amen. Would you stand with me as we close in prayer? Father God, your word is good, and it challenges us, it reveals to us the areas in our lives that are so out of order, but not so that we can try and fight harder or work better at these things to conquer it and make it happen and drum it up in our lives, but so that we'll fall before you and ask for your grace and your mercy in our lives. And God, I thank you that your mercy is new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I need your mercy and your grace today. And I'm certain that my brothers and sisters here need it as well. And I pray, God, that we would walk in that grace, in the truth of your word, and our focus would be on you. And any of these religious things that we do would only be for the purpose of exalting you higher over our lives. We thank you, Jesus.